Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asks for anything back.
It is a way of life to always honor the environment. It's not something that you just can turn on and off. It's a living daily lifestyle.
And that acknowledgement is a way to acknowledge that we're coexisting in this land with the native people, and we should acknowledge that this is actually their traditional territory. But at the same time, we are all guests to this land.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Today we acknowledge our Treaty 7 friends.
Where the Blackfoot meets and the Elbow bends.
Soon came the Sutina from the Beaver Clan.
Iski and Nakoda in the Mountain Lands.
Last but not least, Métis people from Region 3.
Together we are all Treaty people in Calgary.
Today we mark National Indigenous Peoples Day here at St. Andrews. And it's a day for Canadians actually to recognize and to celebrate the unique heritage, diverse cultures, and outstanding contributions of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. The Presbyterian Church in Canada acknowledges the responsibility of our church, our governments, and all Canadians to continue to work towards healing and justice with Indigenous peoples. Presbyterians do support 9 different ministries to Indigenous peoples across our country. And today, we are going to not only welcome Melody Courage and her singing, but also Ernie Poundmaker, who is a Cree elder and a friend of St. Andrews. And he will be offering not only a prayer in Cree, the prayers of our people, but also he'll be offering some reflections to us as friends of his. Today, I also wish a happy Father's Day to all the dads in our midst. We're grateful to God, especially for fathers who illustrate God's goodness of compassion and service. And these are the values of our community here at St. Andrews that we are holding up today and learning more about. And so welcome to worship at St. Andrews Calgary. Let us worship, let us pray. Compassionate God, you are the source of life and love. We gather in your presence this day to wonder at the beauty and complexity of all that you have made. To acknowledge how small and insignificant we are in this amazing universe, and to admit how much we really need you. We confess that we have too often tried to do life on our own steam, through our own thinking and ingenuity, but it just doesn't work. We try through willpower to serve in the footsteps of Jesus, but still we look to our own interests first. We try to love our neighbors, but we are so good at finding fault in others and withholding our love. We try to do justice and care for the vulnerable, the poor, the marginalized, the excluded, and the outcast. But we end up being silent rather than taking a stand in compassionate service. Forgive us. Remind us again how much we need you and the energetic life of your spirit to empower us for gospel good in our city and our world. Just as clay is given into a potter's hands, so this day we surrender ourselves anew into your creative spirit. Use us for greater compassion, for greater service of others, and open wide our hearts to our neighbors, especially those who are suffering. In this time of worship, O God, we remember again that you are kind, you are just, you are mercy, and you are compassion. And we give you all praise and honor, love and loyalty with our lips and with our lives to the end of our days. And we make our prayer in the name of Jesus, who prays with us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hello, and welcome once again to my backyard. I hope you had a good week and that you're doing well. I've enjoyed this week and enjoyed sitting outside, which makes me think about your land acknowledgement that you learned. That's pretty good the way you did that with actions. The land treaty is about not owning the land, but realizing that it belongs to another, as it is given to us by God. And we're to take care of it. Do you have some land that you take care of? Maybe you live in an apartment, but you go outside and you can plant some flowers in the apartment building's flower bed. So one of the things that we should value as Christians is God's creation. It's a rainy day by the river up near Sundry. We're to take care of the land. It'd be one of our values that we care for God's creation and all that he has given to us. Because when you say that land acknowledgement, remember that the indigenous people, they were taking care of it, and now it's our turn to help take care of it. So everything you do, let's think about how we can take care of God's earth and honor Treaty 7. I hope you have a great week and a great start to your summer. Let's say a prayer together. Loving God, we thank you for your creation. We thank you for this gift that we are to look after. We give you thanks for our Indigenous brothers and sisters and for what they teach us about keeping the land safe, keeping it well, and keeping it healthy. Be with us this day and evermore. In Jesus' name, amen. I hope you have a good week and a great summer. God bless.
Good morning. As we turn to the Word of God, let us pray. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray that we will open our hearts and minds to your words and to live as examples of your generosity. Listen to the word of God. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Well, today we begin another Sunday on looking at our values as a community of faith, our recently adopted values. And while our vision statement is kind of the picture of the destination of where it is that we are going, our mission statement is like the road that gets us there, and our values are actually the guardrails that keep us together as a community of faith and keep us out of the ditches. And so this month, we have been working through our values and looking at what our core values are. We've already looked at welcoming and accepting and generosity, and today we turn to two more, compassion and serving. Well, Gary wasn't feeling himself. He couldn't put his finger on why. It just something inside of him just didn't feel right. He was 52 years old. He was a custodian at a school. He worked hard, and he also liked to eat lots of meat and gravy. And that night, his wife had to drive him to the ER. But he said to the nurse as he came in, just know that I am not staying because I go on a vacation to Newfoundland tomorrow, and I still plan to do that. And it was just like a curtain at that point that Gary had a stroke. And it was like that curtain just descended right over his left side of his body. And he couldn't lift his arm, he couldn't walk, he couldn't speak. And for the first time in his adult life, he was totally dependent on other people. He couldn't go to the bathroom himself, he couldn't dress himself, and most devastatingly, he couldn't even communicate. But after some days of laying in that hospital bed, Gary began to notice two things that were especially poignant for him. The first was the kind, patient encouragement of the nursing staff for him. And the other was the total sacrificial dedication of his wife to him. And these acts of compassion and service actually completely changed Gary's life as he experienced them. And actually, those two things, the compassionate service, those two things offered him a new leash on life. They gave him the will to be able to live. And so 2 years later, Gary was back to work and able to do most everything again. But the thing that had changed most distinctly was that Gary couldn't stop talking about how compassion had changed his life, awakening him to a whole new quality of life, really. It's really interesting what Jesus chooses to do on this last night together with his disciples before he is betrayed and is killed on the cross. You know, Jesus doesn't spend his time summarizing all of his teaching, making sure they have it down pat for the final exam. But rather, what Jesus does is he takes off his outer robe. Yeah, actually strips down to the flesh, shows his complete humanity, and then he puts a towel around his waist, he pours water into a basin, and he begins to wash his disciples' feet. You could say that he shows them through actions what all of his teaching has meant. It's like a summary, actually. This picture of what happens on this last night together is a summary of everything that he has taught them. And you could say that in this action, he reveals to us the true character of God, that our God is a God of deep compassion. As Psalm 103 says, like a parent feels compassion for their children, that's how the Lord feels compassion for those who honor him. So that word compassion means two things. It's a put-together word, and it means to suffer, the passion part, right? We've heard of Jesus' passion. And then the calm points to together. So compassion means to suffer together, to empathize with others, to feel the pain of others, to take it on ourselves and to bless them, to help them, to stand with and to stand by those who are in pain and suffering. And so if you take a read through any of the Gospels, you'll see that this was at the center of Jesus' ministry the whole time. This is one of the qualities of God's character that we can define. You know, God is love, God is mercy, God is justice, God is kindness, and God is compassion. So in our suffering, though others may stand aloof in judgment or holding tight to stereotypes and half-truths, maybe even assuming the worst, Jesus has this heart of compassion for all. No one is excluded from the circle of his grace and his compassion. And especially we see in Jesus this heart for those who are unfairly treated, those who are marginalized, and those who are intentionally excluded. Jesus not only sees them, but he is constantly reaching out to them, and he is trying to bring them in and to try to break down the barriers that others have created to exclude them. And so you could say that Jesus' parable of the Good Samaritan is really a summary that encapsulates both his compassion, you know, the way that the guy who's beaten up and robbed is cared for compassionately, and then the service of taking him to a hotel and paying for his care for at least a couple of weeks. Now then there's the washing of feet that maybe we now associate with church, even on Monday, Thursday. Some of you have even had your feet washed or washed other people's feet. But there's a bit of a different context in Jesus' time because, remember, feet were the main way that people traveled. And so that meant that people had dirty feet. They were most unpleasant. And in Middle Eastern culture, even to today, the foot is actually considered the most offensive part of the body. You know, I can remember as a theology student actually sitting on a bench in a Russian Orthodox church in Jerusalem on a Saturday night vigil. And we were sitting, it was a long service, we were sitting there for a while. All of the Orthodox people were, of course, standing while we Westerners were sitting. And I just put my right ankle up across my left knee, you know, crossed my leg. And out of nowhere, this Russian nun came over and she slapped my leg. And then she looked at me quite sharply and said something to me in Russian that I did not understand. And I looked to our leader, I was shocked, and our leader whispered to me, "In this culture, you never show anyone the bottom of your foot. It is a total insult." And so I don't know if you have a memory for a news conference that then President George Bush was doing, and there was a reporter in the crowd, a Middle Eastern man, who took off his shoe and threw it at the president. See, again, this is the greatest insult that you can do, because the shoe is next to the foot. And it's meant to just amplify what Jesus is doing here in washing of feet. Here we see his total compassionate service by washing his disciples' feet. And you could tell in the story how uncomfortable Peter is. He bristles at this, but our Lord insists, and there is something deeply life-changing that happens in that compassionate service that happens here. It's like a holy intimacy that happens. Many times before, Jesus has spoken about his love for his disciples. Yet in this one single act of compassion and humble serving, Jesus tries to sum up all of those words in a way that they will never forget. He tries to sum up the entire meaning of his death and his resurrection, which can wash us clean. It's like so much of Jesus' compassionate work was about restoring the fouled or the broken to a condition of cleanness and renewed health. And this great compassion is really the heart of Jesus to each one of us. And as with Gary, whom I mentioned earlier, this compassion, not when it's just talked about and put in words like I'm putting it in words now, but it's when it's put into actions that it changes our lives. And these, you may even have your own story of how an act of compassion and service to you changed your whole outlook and direction. Because everything that Jesus has done and said and undergone is meant to show us that the love that we most long for is actually given to us by God, that we can trust that love, because God is a God of love. And this complete assurance makes it possible for us even to be able to honestly face our own sinful selves and to confidently know that Jesus' compassion can transform even our broken human condition from a dirty cause of despair into a clean new source of hope. We are indeed in covenant with a God who is never boxed in by limitations, a God who always speaks clean newness, even in a world that always seems irreparably fouled and mucked up. Our God dismantles what is old in our lives and calls us to welcome and live towards this newness. Our compassion as Christians is born from the love and compassion of God, that the love that God has for each of us unconditionally. But when you realize that the same God who loves you unconditionally also loves everyone else unconditionally as well, loves all human beings, then that's when a new way of living opens up itself to us. You know, it reminds me of a famous quote from an American monk, Thomas Merton, and he wrote this once. It's been circulated a lot. In Louisville, at the corner of 4th and Walnut, in the center of a shopping district, I was suddenly overwhelmed with the realization that I loved all of these people, that they were mine and I theirs, that we could not be alien to one another, even though we were total strangers. And that's what the compassion of God does to each of our hearts. Just as Jesus gives his very self to others in compassionate serving, so each of us is called to give ourselves to our brothers and sisters and to be especially eagle-eyed, as Jesus is, about those who are excluded, those who are pushed to the margins, those who are persecuted, those who are wounded and abused. So the pandemic has clearly pointed us to the racism and the bias that is part of our, not only just our Canadian culture, but our city here in Calgary, particularly towards Asians, Blacks, Indigenous people, LGBTQI people? Or how about even in the culture of money, how people with less are viewed as being less, something that Jesus would be totally repulsed by? How can we offer ourselves in compassionate service to these and to others, to those that other people sometimes don't even see? As children of light, it becomes possible to be able to actually give all that we have away in compassionate service for others and become witnesses to the unlimited love of God. Giving all actually becomes gaining all. We are fully alive when we are serving others. Methodist founder John Wesley said this: "Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can." Well, today we're marking National Indigenous Peoples Day, and we remember the way that our Indigenous people here in North America welcomed European explorers and settlers and often served and rescued us from certain death in this harsh new land. However, unlike Jesus, we chose the fouled ways of cultural superiority and worked to institutionalize indigenous exclusion, marginalization, poverty, and the destruction of their culture and their way of life. It's time for us to honestly face our own sinful selves and to remember anew our God, whose will and way is able to dismantle what is old in us and calls us to welcome and to live towards newness. And today I'm happy to welcome Cree Elder Ernie Poundmaker, who is a compassionate friend of St. Andrew's. And today he will lead our prayers of the people, and they will be spoken in Cree. And he will also reflect a bit to help us to think about being compassion and service to our neighbors. Welcome, Ernie.
Good morning, once again. My name is Ernie Poundmaker, and I originally from the Cree tribe in northern Saskatchewan. However, I've been residing here in Calgary now for 47 years, and I still work part-time with the Aboriginal Friendship Center of Calgary, and I still do work in the community as well in the area of language retention, as well as I do a lot of cultural and spiritual programming as well for the city and different agencies, different groups in the city. So I'm happy to be here with you again. Before I start, I'd like to extend a prayer. And my prayer usually begins with giving thanks for this life, giving thanks for this day, and send out a prayer to all people, especially those that are disadvantaged. And I speak for the homeless and those ones battling addictions as well. And so my prayer is the same. Every day when I sit down to do this in the morning, my prayer always goes out to those people. And so I extend a prayer today for all people again. And I'm going to pray in my language, and I'm going to ask you to pray in your language as well. And so I'll start by saying, Nanaskumon, Mamo Notawima. Asami napega, emiwa patama kutakisko. Ginnanaskumtnan. Kapi miwna guhtain gak yogi goya samina nuska giskak. Hami nagpega, kihtama samina, pe mam sirutatnan, mamo notawima. Aktimagihtat, aktimaginat. Inta simsnan, nus simsnan, nuska giskaga samina. Haminan piksquesta manan, nuakwa magannan, kagwatagihtata nuska giskag. Piksquesta manan matesa gamiumskam gamias niguista. Gamiumskam, miumam tenechigeon, piatagemon mina. So aim, nugget aim. Minanaga we suck the head and oskagiskag. Big squest a monan. Kayaka sinu matesa. Ute, umam tenetigan. An oskagiskag. Weetsga posto. Tamagan out to magitown, wakumagan axio gumgo, kapimsik an oskagiskag. A matesa. Kamu ayo, kamu pasigo, asamina pego. Ah, Tamagi told me, na, get there I seem. Needs waps to go on a noskagiskag, a noskagiskag, my taste of gamias in you. A Tamag not, a Tamagi thought twister. Ah, my taste of muggy gray, pay my statue, go pay one eye. So, nugget aim me, na, and scream none again, noskagiskag. Can I get talk at a chick, can I get aim at a quister? So, nugget aim me, gachio. Amina, mae tygi am o teg ym ios, gach iawg i gwe. Ag ym iws apostwch dan an me gwaith o mae mae nhw gan i bawia, ga wisag dehe a gach iawg. Amate, pe wyt ti nad, pe wyt ga pwys daw nad, pe si trysgaw nad gwes ma des, gach iawg an os gag isgag. Ag eich sy'n eich steis bach se mwy an, mae tygi am gym ios, dyma gynnaw nad, nag y dem nad gach iawg. Hai, hai. Internationalist. Oh. So we continue to pray in light of all things that we face as First Nations people, wherever we are in this country. Our prayer and our sacrifices and our ceremonies have sustained us through some very troubling and challenging times, as witnessed by what came forward here a few short weeks ago with the discovery of these young bodies that were unearthed in Kamloops. As First Nations people, we always were aware of what happened in those institutions. Our people still speak of those things, those horrors, being torn apart from their parents and their grandparents and their community. And my mother-in-law always spoke of this as well, witnessing that. It was very painful to hear. But now that pain has been brought to another level with the discovery of these bodies. And I feel for Indigenous people all across this country, because I think in one way or another we were all affected by the residential schools, the legacy of the residential schools. And I can only think from the perspective of being a grandfather and a father and an uncle, how it must feel to send your children off to be educated and to never see them again. And no explanation was given to you. How it must feel for people to not have any closure as to the whereabouts of their siblings, to never see them again, to have them not come home. They were put in the hands of people that claimed to be messengers of God and a good way to live. And to find that much of the horrors were perpetrated by these same people on young, innocent, harmless children. And the effects of those are still being felt today by survivors and those descendants of those survivors that still grapple with addictions and pain and the legacy that was left behind by the churches because it destroyed many people. And all you have to do is look at our federal institutions, our correctional institutions that house a large part of our Indigenous community. We comprise a large percentage of the inmate population. And you look at the condition of our people that live on the street, the homeless population. You have to look at where that pain and suffering came from. Our people forgot their parenting skills because our traditional parenting skills were stripped from us when we entered into these residential schools. Our language was lost. What does that do to an adult today that walks with brown skin but can't speak his language? What does that do to him? What does that do to his self-worth, his self-esteem? So you look at all these things. And how do we reconcile that? How do we get over that pain and start looking at something good, something positive? How do you do that? And it's difficult. And so what we do as an Indigenous community is to bring back those ceremonies, start empowering people again. And how you do that is to build a strong foundation that what we have as the First Nations is good, that our teachings are good because they teach us how to live in this world. But it also reminds us of the value system that we have, what was taught to us, what was handed down to us, and what is reinforced by our ceremonies, those things that relate to kindness and sharing and caring and showing compassion to one another, to all people. So I applaud St. Andrew's Presbyterian. I've had the pleasure of working with St. Andrew's in our cultural sharing day. And I've shared many of my thoughts with the church as well. And I hope to continue to do that. And I want to commend you because you're the first organized church group that has stepped forward to allow us to do this here, to allow us to be a part of your your worship ceremony. And I want to thank you and keep praying for all of us. Pray for all of mankind. Because I look at that medicine wheel. It's got four colors in there. Black, red, yellow, and white. That represents the four races of mankind that were placed here. And we all belong in a circle. That represents the family of man. Let's get back to that now. Let's start showing our humanity. We're better than this. We're better than this. Let's show the world now that we can come together and make things good again. So thank you for giving me this opportunity to share this message with you. And I hope it's received in a good way, in a kind way, in a respectful way. I want to thank you once again. My English name is Ernest Poundmaker. My Indian name is Mahtau Spagan, Strong Pipe. Aho, thank you. Ginnernaskumtna. Ai, ai.
Well, I want to thank you, Ernie, for being here with us today and to share truth with us and also to share hope with us today. And if you would like to listen to his full address, we will be making this available this week through our congregational email and also through our website as well. And you can hear one more additional bit that we had to edit out this morning, but we're very grateful for Ernie's being present to us today here and for his friendship. Now we remember our Lord Jesus who makes it possible for us to be able to give away all that we have in compassionate service for others, and through that to become witnesses of unlimited love of God. Giving becomes gaining all for us. And let us remember again John Wesley's words, to do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, and at all times you can, to all people you can, as long as ever you can. Our morning tithes and offerings will be received.
Oh,
Let us pray. God of promise and perseverance, we offer our gifts with thankful hearts, grateful for the great gift of your compassion and your willingness to suffer with us. Your love invites us to serve and also to share in the suffering and pain of others. Use us, we pray, for the healing of our city, our country, our world. And we pray that you would bless these gifts that we bring. With your Spirit's power, use them so that we can grow life together with God, always with a spirit of life-changing compassion and service. For the sake of Christ Jesus, our Lord, we pray. Amen. Well, again, a welcome to worship here at St. Andrew's Calgary, and a happy Father's Day to all of the dads in our midst. Hope that you can have some special time to be able to celebrate today. Also, I want to mention a word of congratulations to those who will graduate this week. Our prayers go with you and our blessing as you look not only to completing your studies, but also of the next chapter that will come. God bless you all. As many of you already know, Reverend Jan and John Hazlett are moving to Southern Ontario to be closer to their families. And so they'll be leaving Calgary this summer. And we want to be able to say farewell to them. And that will be happening next Sunday when Reverend Jan will be assisting me in leading Sunday worship. And as there are folk in the sanctuary this week, in-person worship will continue next week. And with AHS regulations loosening a bit, we can now accommodate up to 50 people. So please spread the word so that we can start to regather as a community for in-person. And all safety regulations will be maintained when you come. So I hope that there'll be 50 of you here in the sanctuary with us next week, because it's time for us to begin regathering as a community of faith. I also wanted to just make a brief word about our recent General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church in Canada that was held earlier this month. It's the first Zoom assembly that we have had, and you can imagine that it was a huge learning curve for the church. There was nothing that was usual about this particular General Assembly. And it also concluded the term of Amanda Curry from Saskatchewan, who was moderator for the first time in our history for 2 years instead of the usual one. The assembly was marked by further work on reconciliation and healing with our Indigenous peoples in Canada, and it also featured the remits on human sexuality that had received the necessary support from our presbyteries and have now been passed by the General Assembly. And if you'd like to know more about the details, just go to our Presbyterian Church in Canada website and you can find more details there. COVID had delayed some of our work that we wanted to do on discernment around human sexuality here at St. Andrew's Church. But you'll be hearing more soon from our task force on human sexuality and the discernment initiatives that we will undertake here at St. Andrew's Church. Just want to remind you that we do have in-person folk here today, and I'll be greeting them outside on the sidewalk, and then after that I will be joining the preacher's Zoom. So we'll be continuing in both ways for the next while. So some folk from St. Andrew's will start the conversation, and I'll join you as soon as I can. I also wanted to make mention today of Susan Boudou and her children who are here in the sanctuary today. Susan and Justin and their family are going to be moving to Toronto, and we are really sad to see you go. And today we're so glad that you're here in person, that we can bid you farewell in God's blessing. We have so appreciated your ministry in our midst, especially the work that you've done through Alpha, and we know that God has more plans for both of you in ministry going ahead and your family. So we bless you, and in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and send you forth in blessing to others. Finally, we do have a couple videos that we'll run right now. One of them comes from stewardship, and then just a word about our joy garden.
Hi everyone, John Cuthbertson here on behalf of the St. Andrew's Finance team with a short update. First, thanks to everyone who's been so generous in your support. It's really heartwarming and wonderful. And thanks again to the Haynes family for their donation to the Legacy Fund in memory of Norm and Linda. We celebrate that very generous gift. As at the end of May, we have a small operational surplus of approximately $12,000. Our PAR contributions are rock solid, and their predictability is crucial support. We've also received funds from people who have made five-year pledges for amounts over and above their normal givings. Thank you. Our electronic and envelope givings are off by about 30%, which is likely COVID related, but we've seen savings on the expense side, mainly in the building maintenance and congregational teams budgets. These savings are also due to the fact that we are effectively closed for in-person activities. We have been fortunate to apply for and receive help from both the federal and provincial COVID programs, and this, with the other factors just mentioned, has given us that small surplus. We have some exciting news for you. For several years now, we have been aware that our kitchen fire suppression system and ventilation need upgrading to current code and safety requirements. The Ladies Guild has been saving for this exact purpose for quite a few years now, and they have generously offered a contribution of $39,000 to help fund this. Because our undesignated cash position is currently strong, we believe that we can prudently fund the remaining amount on an interim basis of approximately $30,000. As a result, we and the facilities team are both recommending to session that this project start now to take advantage of the summer weather and the fact that the building is closed. Two final closing thoughts. Our team has worked closely with all the other teams, and what stands out is that there are tons of people doing tons of things to support St. Andrew's and advance our mission. Kudos to you all. Lastly, summer is traditionally a harder time for us to maintain our giving profile. We would just ask that you don't forget St. Andrew's in your generous stewardship. Thanks so much.
Rainbow and the heart and the ladybug turned out pretty good. So I'll take these to the church and put them into the garden. Hopefully you'll make some rocks that'll join them. So they don't have to be perfect or they don't have to be fancy. They just have to bring you and other people joy.
The amazing thing about the love of Christ is that the compassion of Jesus can change us so that when we stand on a street corner, we can look at all of those people and we can say that we love them all. And that's the kind of compassion that Christ can grow in our hearts, a compassion and love for all in our world. Go to grow greater compassion and service and grow life together with God and be blessed. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and always, amen.
Mir fällt, dein Blick hat mich.